In our previous video, we have discussed classes and all the basic details of classes we have discussed. Along with that, we have also completed what is polymorphism. We are currently discussing inheritance and their properties, out of which we have completed what is inheritance, what are the different types of inheritance available, how to define a subclass, the characteristics of inheritance we have completed. We have also discussed what are the visibility controls available for classes and class members. Then we discussed how the constructors are to be designed in the derived classes. Then we have started talking about what is method overriding or how runtime polymorphism can be implemented. We have seen interesting demo programs also. Now, when we take overriding methods or virtual methods, these are some of the points that we have to remember while designing or defining any virtual method in the base class or in inheritance concept. So we are going to see some of the important points to be remembered when we define virtual methods in the base class. We use virtual methods to implement runtime polymorphism or late binding. A virtual method is a method that can be redefined in the derived class. We have seen how to redefine it. When you redefine, you declare the method as an override method in the derived class. A virtual method has an implementation both in the base class as well as in the derived class. Remember, implementation will be there for a virtual method both in the base class as well as in the derived class. It is used when a method's basic functionality is the same, but sometimes more functionality is required in the derived class. Only then we will go for the overriding methods. Also, when a method is declared as a virtual method in a base class and that the method has the same definition in a derived class, then there is no need to override it in the derived class. If you want to have same functionality, you need not override it. You can directly use the virtual method in your derived class. You can directly invoke the virtual method in the derived class, because the virtual method will be automatically inherited in the derived class. But when a virtual method has different definition in the base class and the derived class requires to override it, the derived class, then in the derived class you want a different definition, then there is a need to override it in the derived class. I repeat, when a virtual method has a different definition in the base class and the derived class wants a completely different definition, then there is a need to override it in the derived class. This is very important. So you override a method only when you want to redefine it or you want to have some more functionalities in the derived class. A virtual function allows derived classes to replace the implementation provided by the base class. This we have already seen in the examples. All the virtual methods that are available in the base class has got a re-implementation in the derived class using override keyword. By the time the compiler makes sure the replacement is always called whenever the object in question is actually of the derived class, even if the object is accessed by a base class pointer rather than a derived class pointer. We have seen that how a base class pointer can point to a derived class object. A is equal to new capital B open close parenthesis. I think you remember that particular example. A is a reference of the base class. A is the reference of the base class, and it is pointing to an object of class B, which is a derived class. In that example, we have clearly seen how the overridden method can be invoked both by the base class pointer as well as the derived class pointer. So this allows algorithms in the base class to be completely replaced in the derived class. So these are some of the points you have to remember, and all these points we have discussed in the example programs also. So if you are asked to elaborate on the properties or the features of virtual methods, you can write all these points in your examination. Now the next very important concept that is coming under inheritance is abstract classes and abstract modifiers. Let us see what are they. Abstract modifier. So if I want to have abstract modifier, we will be using the abstract keyword. And the abstract modifier indicates that the thing being modified has a missing or incomplete implementation. Whatever is having the abstract modifier is not having any implementation. The implementation has to be defined by whoever is using that abstract thing. That is what it says. The abstract modifier indicates that the thing being modified has incomplete implementation. So there is no implementation defined. It has just specified the abstract thing can be implemented whoever is using it in their class. Now if you take the abstract modifier, it can be used with a class, it can be used with a method, or it can be used with properties and indexes, or even it can be used with events. When you use the abstract modifier in a class declaration, it is to indicate that a class is intended only to be a base class of other classes and not instantiated on its own. So what happens if you use abstract modifier for a class? It will specify the class as a base class only. You cannot instantiate. That means you cannot create an object for that particular class. That is an abstract class. But whereas if you use abstract modifier for a member, if a member is marked as abstract, it must be implemented by a non-abstract classes that derive from the abstract class. So if you have a member declared as an abstract member, then the abstract member must be implemented in the derived class as a non-abstract member. So you will be deriving it in a non-abstract class. In the non-abstract class, you have to give an implementation for it. It is mandatory. So let us see what is an abstract class now. An abstract class acts as a base class and need not be instantiated. So if you want a class to act as a base class and need not be instantiated, then you can declare that class as an abstract class. And remember, abstract class cannot be instantiated. That means you cannot create objects for that particular class. So this is how we will be declaring an abstract class. You use the abstract keyword class and you give the class name, then all the class members will be declared here. Now this is a simple example which you might have already come across. You can have shape as an abstract class. Then this class can be inherited by rectangle, circle and triangle. And when you see here, the common property properties that will be shared by the subclasses. The common properties that will be shared by the subclasses can be defined in the base class, which is an abstract class. For example, here shape is an abstract class, color is common to all the shapes, area is common to all the shapes, or getting color of that particular shape can be common to all the shapes. The same way, if you want to convert it to string, that can also be considered as common to all the shapes. So these are the common properties that we can define for shapes. So what I do, I take all these common properties here in the abstract class, then you can go for inheriting them. And when you inherit, for the circle, all these members will be inherited, but you have to give implementation. You have to give implementation. And it can have its own unique data member also. The same way here, rectangle inherits all these four members. Along with that, it has its own members also. So for the color, whatever kind of implementation you want, that can be done here. Whatever kind of implementation you want, that can be done here. For area, whatever implementation you want here, that can be done here, because both the implementation will be different. Finding area of a circle is totally different from finding area of a rectangle. So you just specify, it can be an abstract method which is to be implemented here in the non-abstract classes, which you call as the concrete class. So an abstract class is to provide a common definition that multiple derived classes can share. For example, a class library may define an abstract class, and programmers using that library can provide their own implementation of the class by creating derived classes. Now, whenever you have abstract classes, it cannot be instantiated, it cannot be sealed. We will be discussing what is sealed. Sealing means the class cannot be inherited. That is what you call as sealed. So, abstract classes are generally used only for inheritance, whereas if you seal, it cannot be inherited. So, abstract classes cannot be declared as a sealed class. And the abstract classes can have only abstract members. All the members are abstract, which are to be re-implemented in the derived classes. Now next, let us see what is abstract members. And abstract classes also define abstract methods. Abstract methods are implicitly virtual methods and will not provide any implementation. When I say any implementation, it will not have any body of the method. It will not have body of the method. That is what you call as no implementation in the abstract method. But it is defined generally by adding the keyword abstract before the return type of the method. For example, inside the abstract class, I am going to define an abstract method. I define abstract method, and here before the return type, I am using the abstract keyword, and I give the method name and the parameters. And observe here, after the parameters, I am not using curly braces, I am using semicolon. So this is how you generally define a function prototype. I hope all of you remember or recollect how to define function prototype in C and C++. So you don't have any implementation. Method body will not be there. You just specify what is the return type, what is the name of the function and the parameters. Then you give semicolon, which you call as the function prototype. The same way here, the abstract method will be defined only with the return type, method name and the parameters and semicolon, so that you are forced to implement it in the derived class. Let us see a demo program. So this is a demo program. As usual, you will have the using directive for the system namespace, and I am going to declare a class called shape as an abstract class, and any shape for that matter will have area, finding area as a method. So what I do, inside the shape class I declare an abstract method which will be returning an integer, and I call the method name as getArea, and there is no implementation here, it is only semicolon. Now I am going to inherit this shape for another class called a square, and I declare one side for that particular square, and here I am going to have a constructor, and then the getArea method declared here in the shape abstract class is implemented here like this. It is implemented here like this. Now when you see the implementation, the abstract method is implemented in the derived class using the override keyword. Using the override keyword, it is implemented here. Then in your main program, you can define an object of square, and you can invoke the getArea method to display the area of the square. Now if you see here, shape is an abstract class which cannot be instantiated. You cannot create an object. So if I give this particular statement, it is going to give you an error, because shape is an abstract class for which an object cannot be created. So let us see this program in the terminal. Let me increase the size. I open the program. So this is the program we have seen, getArea method I have declared, and you can observe here how, what is the symbol I have used for a single statement method. I am not using any curly braces, return, etc., etc. You can observe all these things here. This is the constructor, and this is the getArea method. In the getArea method, I am going to return only a single value, and I have only one statement here, so I can use a shortened form for the method. I create an object of square, and I am displaying the area of that square. So let me execute this program. Which will be an exe file. You can see 12 is the site measure, and I am getting area as 144. Now suppose, say for example, if I try to create an object of the abstract class, and when I compile, it will give you an error. It says you cannot create an instance of abstract class because shape is an abstract class. This is not possible. You cannot create an object for an abstract class. And there is another demo program. Let us see what is that program. So this example I have got from the Microsoft document for C# reference. I create an abstract class. I am creating two data members. Observe here. Underscore x and underscore y, and I initialize some values also. This is possible inside the abstract class. Then I am having three abstract methods. We have seen abstract modifier can also be used for properties and indexes, not only for the method, it can be used for properties and indexes. So here I am using the abstract keyword for a method and I am using it for properties called x and y. So they are only read only properties. So what I do, I have to inherit it in the derived class. So when I inherit in the abstract method called abstract method, I am overriding it. So when you have abstract, it must be overridden. So abstract methods are implicitly virtual methods. Abstract methods are implicitly virtual methods without any implementation. Please note, abstract methods are implicitly virtual methods without any implementation. So if it is a virtual method, we have to override it. You go for overriding it and same signature will be used. And inside the abstract method, I am just incrementing the value of x and y. The same way I have properties int x and int y. So int x is again overridden. And the get method, you can see here, get method is not having any open close curly braces. So here in the get method, I am returning the value of minus x plus 10 and int y minus, sorry, not minus, underscore y plus 10. So you are overriding the property. And in the main class, you are declaring a derived class variable. You are declaring a derived class variable. Invoke the abstract method and display the value of x and y. And when you access it, you are accessing the x value, underscore x value using the property capital X. You are accessing the underscore y value using the property capital Y. And you can see here both of them are protected variables. Protected variables. So automatically it can be accessed only inside the derived class. It cannot be accessed outside the derived class. So this is another example that shows that how the abstract keyword can be used to define methods as well as the properties. So two demo programs we have seen. So let us see the features of abstract members. Abstract methods definition, which will be your prototype, method prototype, is followed by a semicolon instead of normal method block. Normal method body will not be there. Normal method implementation will not be there. It will be immediately followed by a semicolon. Derived classes of the abstract class must implement all the abstract methods. We have seen in the example. So all the abstract methods, one method was there in the example. I will show you again in the example. One abstract method is there, two abstract properties are there. All these abstract contents are implemented here in the, they are implemented here in the derived classes. When an abstract class inherits a virtual method from a base class, the abstract class can override the virtual method with an abstract method. I repeat, when an abstract class inherits a virtual method from a base class, the abstract class can override the virtual method with an abstract method. We will see an example. I have a non-abstract class here, class D, inside which I have a virtual method. I have a virtual method. Now I am defining an abstract class. I am defining an abstract class which is inheriting a non-abstract class. That is what it says. When an abstract class inherits a virtual method from a base class. Yes, it is inheriting a virtual method from the base class. Then you can use override, you can use override along with the abstract keyword for this. Then abstract classes E, which can be inherited again for class F, there again you have to override for the new implementation, so that automatically this implementation will be hidden for class F. It can be hidden for class F. You can go through all these things here. So the virtual method can be inherited here, but you must override it to declare it as an abstract method, which can be again inherited in the derived class, and there you can give new implementation for the virtual method. So when you have the abstract members, it cannot have implementation. Of course, no implementation is defined in the abstract method. You give only semicolon, and its implementation is given in non-abstract derived classes by overriding the methods. It can be declared only in abstract classes. It cannot take virtual or static modifier. Abstract members can be inside only abstract classes. Note this point. You can define abstract members only in an abstract class, and you cannot have virtual or static modifier for the abstract members. An abstract declaration is permitted to override a virtual method also. That is what in the example we have seen. You can override the abstract declaration. You can override a virtual method. You can override a virtual method in the abstract declaration. That is also possible. So these are some of the points you have to remember in the abstract classes and abstract members. So whenever in your program, if you have some common definitions which are to be implemented in different ways in multiple derived classes. I repeat, you have common definitions which are to be implemented in different ways for multiple derived classes, then you can use abstract class. Inside the abstract class, you can have only abstract members, and all these members must be implemented in the derived class. We have seen a demo program also. So most of the time, if you have some global variables, if you have some common methods and properties to be implemented, you can go for the abstract classes and abstract members. In the next video, we will be discussing about what are sealed classes and sealed methods. Thank you.